Yes, folks, it's back. American football.
Hi, and welcome to a new series of American Football on Channel 4, with a new set and new presenters. I'm Angelo Abela.
And I'm Andy Smart.
And over the next 20 weeks, we're going to be looking at some of the best games of American football, looking at some of the finer points and some of the personalities you'll be seeing on the way to Super Bowl 22.
That's right. And this year, we'll be going out twice a week, on Tuesdays at 10 and Sundays at 6:15. On the Tuesday night show, you'll be able to see extended coverage of a game, usually the one shown on Monday night all over America. And on Sundays, we'll be looking at another game and some of the news and results from that week.
And over here, we're going to be looking at some of the plays and some of the rulings that you'll be seeing in each game. Do you understand this? This, to me, looks like a tango dance step. And over here, we can see some referees breakdancing. I know what this one means. This one means that somebody scored, but who... Somebody who knows everything all about American football is Andy. And Andy's now going to explain the basic rules to all of us. If I can find him. Andy? Andy?
Hi, I'm in the locker room and this is my demonstration table, which I'll try and take you through a few basic points with.
Okay, now. Explain away.
Right, well, each squad consists of 45 players. Now, these are split into the offensive team, the defensive team, and the special team.
90 players on the pitch at the same time?
No. They're only allowed to send on 11 players per side.
Right.
Okay? Now, if you were attacking, you'd send on your offense. If you were defending, you'd send on your defense.
And what does the special team do?
They specialise in kicking.
Sounds painful.
No, the ball. They kick the ball.
Oh, right, okay.
Right.
So how do we play then?
Well, the game is split into four 15-minute periods, and during which each side has to try and score as many points as possible.
And how do you score a point?
Well, the game works on a four-down system, which means that the attacking team...
That's the offensive team.
Right. Have four goes to get the ball at least 10 yards down the pitch. If they do that, they keep possession.
And so they've scored.
No. Look, watch this.
Every play starts with the centre of the offence lifting the ball off the ground through his legs and into the hands of the quarterback. This is called the snap. Now the quarterback has three options open to him. He can give the ball to a running back who tries to run down the field with the ball. Or he can run with the ball himself. This is called the scramble. And lastly, he can throw the ball forward to another member of his team. On this play, the quarterback throws the ball forward and it's caught before the ball touches the ground. And that's a complete pass.
It looks a complete mess.
No, it's very carefully planned out. Now, the ball has travelled 5 yards into the opposition's territory, so now we go to second and five, which means second down with 5 more yards still to get. And this time, John Elway, the quarterback, is going to throw the ball to number 23, Sammy Winder, with a backward pass. He then runs 3 more yards down the field until he is tackled. This means it goes to third down and two.
That's the third down with 2 yards still to get. I get it. It's quite simple, really.
Now, on this play, watch the attacking linemen as they force a hole through the defence. And Sammy Winder dives through the gap to gain the necessary 2 yards.
That means they've now got a total of 10 yards.
Right.
So they've scored?
No. It means they get another 4 downs and so on until they get it down to the end zone.
Right.
Now, let's have a look at a team in a scoring position. So they've moved the ball down the pitch, a series of plays, and got it to within 11 yards of the end zone.
Now, if the quarterback can get the ball to one of his own players in the end zone, they'll score a touchdown. Elway steps back, throws the ball. Touchdown!
But he didn't touch it down.
No, you don't have to. You just have to have possession of the ball in the end zone.
Oh, right, okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's the attacking team up 1-0.
No, that's 6-0.
Six?
Yeah, you get 6 points for a touchdown, and then you get an extra point if you do this.
They're getting ready to kick it, so it must be the special team.
That's right.
So the special team comes on after every touchdown.
Yeah, or if the attacking team had failed to score a touchdown on their third down, they would probably have brought on their special unit for the fourth down to kick a field goal, and that's worth 3 points.
Right, I think I've got it now. There are three ways to score. A touchdown, a conversion, or a field goal.
There's just one other way, the safety. Now we know the rules, it's time to watch a game.
Wait. A safety? How do you get a safety?
All right, I'll explain. Watch this.
Now, a safety is worth 2 points, and this happens when an attacking player is caught with the ball in his own end zone. In this case, the unfortunate player is John Elway, the Broncos quarterback, being caught by the Giants' defense in last year's Super Bowl.
Right, offense, defense, attacking points, field goals. I think I've got it now. I'm sure I've got it, right? Let's see a game. We're now going to see the highlights of American Bowl 87, which includes some of the plays you won't have seen before.
The American Bowl gave the Broncos and the Rams their first game after the summer break. Even though preseason games are the testing ground for the rookies, old hand Eric Dickerson showed the way with a 6-yard touchdown run to put the first points on the board. Mike Lansford's barefoot kick then took the Rams to 7-0 to set the capacity crowd alight once again. The next points came when Rich Carlis kicked this impressive 41-yard field goal to bring it back to 7-3. But from then on, it was the new boys who took centre stage. Firstly, Mike Clendenin brought the Broncos to within 1 point with a 35-yard field goal just before half-time.
Just in.
And then in the second half, the youngsters, all desperately trying to impress their respective coaches, began to really scrap it out, almost as if the season had already started. And now, as we join Merlin Olsen, a former Ram player, and Dick Emberg, our match commentators, the Broncos have a 2nd and 8 on their own 42-yard line as John Elway is about to get a bit of a surprise.
Elway's first pass of the second half, and Kevin Green is in for the sack, the second for the Rams. And Green, we talked about him earlier, he's brilliant off that ball, very speedy from Auburn, was a fifth round pick 2 years ago, and what a terrific buy that was for the Rams. There's Green, 91. He'll play linebacker or defensive end.
You see him at the bottom of your screen. Look how quickly he goes around Gene Lang, number 33. He's all over Elway before Elway has a chance to set up, and that's the critical thing for a pass rusher from the outside. Good get off, good takeoff, and then that speed around the corner.
Over 80,000 to sell out again at Wembley Stadium for this American football contest. Elway, long yardage situation, scrambling, throwing, has a man open, Steve Watson, and it'll be a first down at the 44 of the Rams. And there's that exceptional talent of John Elway, able to find room and buy time with his legs, and Watson took quite a hit from Johnny Johnson.
The one thing that scares you when you line up defensively against this man is that you think you have him. You've destroyed the play. You've covered the receivers. You've got pressure on him. And suddenly Elway gets out of the pocket, runs to the outside, and still maintains contact with his receivers. Watch this shot. This is the one you mentioned, Dick, right here.
It wasn't Johnson. It was Clifford Hicks coming over, 28, the rookie who made the initial hit, and Johnson just pushed him down.
That's a sandwich job there.
Hicks they like very much. Third round pick. Will Height. The man with a mile-high somersault in the old days when he celebrated a touchdown. He's off and off his feet. And Will Height buys a couple extra yards with that dive down to the 35. It'll be 2nd and 1.
I got to tell you, if I did a dive like that, I'd break my neck. Did you see him came down right on his head and just flipped on over as if it didn't even bother him?
Almost a free down now for the Broncos, who have moved very impressively on this drive. 10.5 minutes remaining, third quarter. Broncos trail the Rams 7-6. Orson Mobley in motion, and he leads the Ball carrier through, fumble, and the Rams have recovered.
No, he's down. They're going to say he's down, I think, Dick.
Apparently, laying down, Jim Collins covered the football, number 50, but Lang's knee was down at the 28-yard line. By the way, there is no instant replay. It was not yesterday in the Hall of Fame game, nor here today in London.
Let's see if Lang is indeed on the ground. There, I think that's a fumble.
Well, it looks like from that angle that it was. But again, because of the nature of this game, first week of the preseason, instant replay, while it will be in effect again this year throughout the 87 season, not used this weekend. It will be later in the preseason. Elway underneath to Mobley, the big tight end. And he's tough to bring down all the way to the 16-yard line before Vince Newsom can drag him out of bounds.
Newsom looked like a dog biting on a tire, truck tire there, just kind of bouncing along behind.
Elway sounds, it looks as if he's audibilizing, and underneath to Mobley, and Newsom having to come a long way. And
that's a mismatch.
Mobley, a giant tight end at 6'5 and 256, and Elway and the Broncos continue their march toward a possible first touchdown for Denver at the 16 of the Rams. Lang hit in the backfield by Greg Meisner, number 69. Former All-American and academic All-American at Pittsburgh.
That play designed to get outside, but Meisner with great penetration very quickly off that ball was able to catch the offside guard and drive him into the backfield and stack that whole play up.
Loss of a couple. It'll be second down and 12. Watson to the right. Vance Johnson to the left. Lang and Wilhite behind Elway. It's Wilhite on the draw. 10. He's to the 6, and that'll be close to a first down.
Well, Ahmad said this crowd was cheering in the wrong places. They seem to have responded very well to this drive by Denver. Quick acceleration, good cutting by Wilhite. He's hit hard, but he already had the first down when they nailed him, or very close to it. It looks like they're going to bring in the sticks.
Newsom and Giroux on the tackle. John Robinson in London had lots of questions about Wimbledon. He's an avid tennis fan and NBA basketball fan. He said he likes the sports where you can see the athlete in motion, and especially his eyes. He's in the wrong sport, except he can look inside those masks. He likes to see the player's intensity and really senses that in tennis and basketball.
Well, he's not terribly thrilled to see that. The measurement does indeed confirm a first down for the Denver Broncos. They're on the 6-yard line, and Elway has taken the ball in the beginning of this second half and stuffed it down the throats of the Ram defense.
He's run it indeed. 39 yards rushing on this drive, Merlin. They had only 23 yards the entire first half. First and goal at the 6 as the Broncos threaten to take the lead here in the third quarter. On the ground again. Lang, touchdown! Defense of the Rams shut off the inside, but there was no one to contain outside. Gene Lang, 6 yards for the Denver score.
Just a bounce out. The play was designed to go off tackle. The Rams had it closed off. It looked like Kevin Green, the outside linebacker, got out of position. Watch the play. It's designed to go off tackle. Lang right there hits the stack and then just bounces to the outside, and nobody's home.
Lang has scored only one touchdown rushing all of last year at but 94 yards rushing. Rich Carlos adds the extra point. And with 8 minutes and 12 seconds remaining in the third quarter, for the first time in American Cup 87 at Wembley Stadium, the Denver Broncos are in the lead. It's 13-7.
So the Broncos in the lead for the first time. And what was supposed to be a bloodless preseason game starts to look a real contest. The two defenses played it tough in the next two drives, and after exchanging punts, it's the Rams with the ball again. First down and 10 on their own 43-yard line.
Ooh. Charles White earns a tough two, and Ricky Hundley, 238 pounds, a linebacker, number 98 for Denver, made the stop. Here comes Hundley out.
I talked about the complexity of this Denver defense. It took Hundley a long time. Of course, he wouldn't sign with Cincinnati when he was drafted, ended up coming to the Broncos, and literally sat for about a year before he was familiar enough with this defense to play. Boy, he knows what he's doing in there now and has really become an effective inside linebacker.
Tim Terrell, 32, joining Charles White in the backfield for Los Angeles behind Dills. Over the middle, wide open is Kevin House, and he's down to the 46 of Denver with a first down. Nine yards for House, who had some big years with Tampa Bay.
It's going to take a while for Ernie Zampezi to instill the changes in this Ram offense that he wants to make, but you can feel a difference already in the passing game. You can sense a greater concentration on it and certainly a lot more confidence in the passing game.
Dills, who preceded Elway at Stanford University at the controls. Former Viking, and Jim Ryan, the outside linebacker, with a blitz and traps his prey. 3:35 remaining in the third period. On first down, Dills sacked for the second time, or at least the Rams quarterbacks suffered their second sack. A reminder to our viewers, we'll be selecting the Budweiser Most Valuable Player in today's game. We'll announce that at the conclusion. Wembley Stadium. When was it, 1966, that the British won the World Cup here, beat West Germany 3-2. Whoops, Roland Jones, anticipating the count, will pick up five. Jones, who set a Denver record with 13 and a half sacks last year. An All-Pro outing for him, one of the highly regarded defensive talents in the National Football League. Ernie Zampezi, we recorded that before the game. He's upstairs, of course, as the offensive coordinator. 8 years in San Diego, the Chargers number one in pass offense, six of the eight under Zampezi. And he's been ticketed by the Rams to improve that aspect of their game. Charles White running through tacklers to the 31-yard line. And it doesn't matter if it's Des Moines or London, you love that kind of running. Rick Dennison finally put the stopper on him, but a first down for the Rams at the 32.
Little pat for Tom Newberry, pulling guard, who got out in front of it. Gave him some help in springing that one open. Duval Love over there to open the way, too.
Love, number 67, a tackle for Irv Pankey, who has not reported to the Rams camp. Pankey sitting out, looking for more dollars.
Ooh.
Not enough this time, as Freddie Gilbert. He joined the Broncos at the start of last season out of the USFL, where he played 3 years with the New Jersey Generals, and they really like Gilbert on the outside. He's 6'4 and 275, college ball at Georgia.
They've helped him to put a lot of strength on that frame. He was not terribly strong when he arrived. He was big, and they really beefed him up. They like him. He moved over to that left end and moved Andre Townsend inside to the nose.
Dills on first down over the middle. Terrell, he's inside the 25 to the 23, and that's the kind of quick-hitting play that Zampezi brings from San Diego, and Robinson loves it. Here's his feelings.
Every organization, I think, is built on the success and the quality of the people they have. We feel we have a great addition to our staff in Ernie Zampezi, long time great coach in the NFL. He's in charge of our passing game. He's going to be the coordinator of our offense. I'm really excited about his ability to teach, his expertise in the passing game, and the quality of man that he is. He's a great addition for us.
Robinson, obviously excited about that acquisition. They've been the most important that the Rams made in the off year. Short yardage play, and over the top goes Charles White. As a collegian, perhaps no one any better than White in making that play, and he picks up the necessary two and another Ram first down in the final seconds of the third quarter. The Broncos scoring early in this period to take the lead 13-7, and now the Rams with a sustained drive down to the Denver 21.
Offense is asserting themselves much more efficiently here in the second half.
Yards rushing almost even.
A lot of jumping around down there too.
Yeah, it's been an amazingly clean visual account by our British and international crew from London. Dills out of the backfield to White, a perfect throw. And White is out of bounds inside the 10, and you just can't throw that pass any better than Steve Dills offered it to White on the dead run.
The Rams have been working since March to time out their passing game. It certainly is paying dividends. Boy, that ball exactly where it had to be to keep him running and in stride downfield.
End of the third quarter. John Robinson, Rams will have first and goal when we return.
Start of the fourth quarter. Rams first and goal at Denver's 9-yard line.
White scores for the Rams, and it's 13 all, 9 yards on the first play of the fourth quarter.
Dickerson isn't the only one that can run. Charles White, who really did not have any very many bright moments during this last year as a running back, certainly has looked impressive here in the second half, running with some youth that some perhaps thought he had lost. Good ball reaction as he breaks to the opening and high steps into the end zone.
And he ran hard throughout that entire series, gained a total of the 42 yards. And now rookie Tim Lasher of Oklahoma will try to give Los Angeles the lead. Steve Dills the hold, Lasher converts. And then what is becoming a very interesting second half. The Rams regain the lead. First play of the second half. Rams 14, Broncos 13, 57 yards in 9 plays. White the touchdown maker. Well, two impressive drives in the second half. First the Broncos with a kickoff and the lead, and then the Rams countering 57 yards in 9 plays. Lasher, who kicked the extra point, will now kick it off deep. Our Gene Lang on the far side and Joe Gudek for Denver. High spinner to Lang at the 7. Slips at the 18-yard line, and Terrell was there to cover number 32 for the Rams. Now the Broncos trailing by a point. Early in the fourth quarter, Gary Kubiak with Dudek the only running back behind him. Throws wide open, Mobley, the tight end. And he rumbles to the 33-yard line. That one could be felt on the Richter scale back in Denver. Williamson, a rookie, made the tackle.
Let's go back to that Ram touchdown run by Charles White. A real SC flavor to this Ram team. John Robinson, of course, came to the Rams after many successful years as a coach for SC. And Charles White, great tailback at SC. 6 of the Ram assistant coaches have also coached at SC, and Ernie Zampezi an SC tie. What is it, Dick?
Well, he played there as well. He was a tailback.
At SC.
He was when the old triple threat days, he punted, passed, and kicked out of that tailback spot. Here's Dudek. He fights to the 36-yard line for 3 Denver yards.
While we're talking about the Ram assistant coaches, one of them is not here. Marv Goo, who coaches the defensive line. Had an operation a little bit earlier, is now in rehab and going through some treatment, and we certainly pass along our best wishes to him for a full and speedy recovery. I know all his Ram coaching assistant friends and all of the team would send along their best wishes to him.
Yeah, they miss him here in London. We'll look forward to seeing him during the regular season. Larry Brooks taking over for Marv Goo in the defensive line. Kubiak throwing deep on the sidelines. He's got his man at the 48-yard line, Mark Jackson. 13 yards. Jackson, who had a superb rookie year. He was a 6th-round pick out of Purdue. His quarterback there, Jim Everett. And Jackson really fit into the Broncos scheme last year. In fact, set a Denver rookie record in yardage, 738.
And we've talked a lot about the Rams passing game under Zampezi. This is Mike Shanahan's style of football. He's the offensive coordinator for Dan Reeves, and they have put together their own brand of passing football that is indeed very exciting.
Dobiak on first down, trying to hit Jackson again at the Ram 30-yard line. Overshoots the mark. Rams going with some youth back in the secondary. Clifford Hicks, the rookie, is at one corner. Greg Williamson, another rookie free agent, Fresno State at the other. Rams cheerleaders trying to get the crowd involved here in the fourth quarter. They've just been here throughout, enjoying the game as it was last year, even in the rain. No one left until the final gun, and now the wave at Wembley.
Not a bad wave either.
Second down and 10. Kubiak on a screen to Lang to the Ram 44-yard line.
Dick, we're a long ways away from the Bronco training camp in Greeley, Colorado, the Ram camp in Fullerton, California, but one thing doesn't change. For a lot of these young players who've dreamed about playing professional football, they're only going to have a few minutes, perhaps in this game and a couple of minutes in another game, to impress their coaches. And for some of them, a whole year's worth of training and preparation and a whole lifetime of dreaming will depend on how they do in those few minutes.
And it might even be one great play that says, well, let's keep the kid another week. Kubiak to the Ram 41-yard line. That's going to be close to a first down. He may have made it on the scramble. Dudek caught in the backfield, and down goes a flag. Duke Schammel made the tackle. Procedure penalty declined as the Rams defense registered a loss anyway. They'll roll that down box, second and a long 10. 11:35 remaining in the fourth quarter. The Rams 14, the Broncos 13. Natil, the rookie, is in the slot, and Gary Jeter, the veteran, number 77, charging into the Bronco line, and then the finger pointing.
He's saying that Winfred Hood moved to jump him off sides. Let's see if we can take a peek. Well, you can't see the hands. Difficult to know who moved first. They're saying that Jeter moved first. Jeter's been around for a while.
So it's okay. 5 yards against the Rams.
Jeter lost that argument, I think we could say.
Number one pick of the Giants 10 years ago out of Southern California, where he was a great All-American.
You'll look at it, no question about it, at the right side of your screen. But like a veteran, he, of course, says, well, he moved. And sometimes you win that argument if you're convincing enough.
We got another Ram player down deep in that line we're going to show you. Jackson gets his feet inbounds as he dances with a first down at the 28 of the Rams. Greg Proud. Williamson, a rookie corner.
Crowd liked that one. They responded well to that one.
So Williamson, a free agent, and they're working on him. He's playing against some pretty tough wide receivers for Denver, and Denver can really throw some speed at you this year with Jackson, Vance Johnson, Ricky Natil. I mean, those
Ready.
Are men that are all ready. If he makes the squad, there are men that all run the 100, down around 9.4, 9.3 or better.
Those cornerbacks are out there all by themselves anyway. And then you see these guys come out there with the sprinter speed. I mean, you start backing up, your legs start shaking. I wouldn't want to be out there.
Both Jackson and Natil to the left, and they run left with Sewell, and now he throws to Natil, and he's inside the 15. Ricky Natil, his first catch for the Broncos.
I asked Dan Reeves how much of the offense he would have in. He said, we'll only have about a week's worth. Well, That's a lot of offense for a week.
Steve Sewell. He threw the pass last year, didn't he, to Elway against the Raiders in that very first game of the season.
You bet. Sewell, a very versatile performer. We mentioned that they're trying to work him more in that fullback position this year, but I imagine they'll also give him a chance to come from that H-back position.
10.5 minutes remain, fourth quarter. The Broncos threaten to regain the lead. Bootleg Kubiak. End zone, Jackson, touchdown! Jackson over the middle brings back memories of Cleveland in overtime.
Sure does. Two great catches, one for a touchdown that pushed that game into overtime, a game that the Broncos were able to come back and win.
And it was a solid throw by Kubiak. He had to gun it through the defense. Extra point is blocked. Wagner's kick blocked.
Snap went awry on that one, but there are flags down, and let's see what happened. Looks like the Rams may have been offside.
Ron Brown appeared to be an 89 in there. They may have a double number. That wasn't Ron Brown, that 89.
Hey, too big.
Might have been 99. Allen Wright from Jacksonville State of Alabama.
Rams coming back on, and I think the Rams were offsides on that play. Give Denver a chance to re-kick. Let's go back and look at Mark Jackson's pattern here. As he breaks across the center, he'll find a window there. Kubiak anticipates that window. Watch that, right in between the two defenders. Beautifully thrown pass.
A couple of rookies back there defending on the play, and they took advantage. A veteran would have closed more quickly from the offside. Now Jackson, a happy man. And he made a lot of folks in Denver smile last year, and apparently off to a good start here in 87. Low snap, but the kick is good. And Denver leads 20-14. Timeout. So each team moving the ball very effectively in the second half. 10 minutes plus remain.
With Denver leading by 6 and time running down in the fourth quarter, the Rams have their work cut out. But they have the ball again, 1st and 10 at their own 30-yard line.
Michael Young, number 88 in for the Rams. He's flipped to the top of your screen. Charles White diving out to the 35. Little disappointed he didn't get more. A gain of 5. Mark Munford, a fourth-round pick from Nebraska. Number 51 made the tackle. He was 3 times all Big Eight. 3 straight years led the Huskers in tackles.
He's another one coming off reconstructive knee surgery. And also a risky draft as considered by some. We'll see how he does in there.
Steve Dills, a veteran in his 9th year. Eludes the rush. Sidearms it to Kevin House, 45-40. Down the sidelines, out of bounds at the 25, the longest play of the game. And Dills, a great job. He got away from a tough rush and sidearmed a strike to House for 39 yards.
That'll help to even up the passing yardage. Just a little crossing pattern. Dills threw traffic and had to thread that ball in there. Good job of getting the toss in there. Watch House now. He just comes across the middle. He expected the pass earlier. That's Darren Como, number 59, trying to cover him. But once House is underway, Como didn't have a chance.
Now the Rams trailing by 6. Dills looking for more into the end zone, and that'll be interference against Michael Young. Lyle Pickens, a rookie from Colorado. Too much body, and that will give the Rams a big penalty.
Well, the benefit of experience. Michael Young has been there a few more times than Lyle Pickens, and he knew how to get the youngster to bump him. A That's interference in the end zone. They'll move it down to the 1 yard line.
Now the fans at that end of the stadium with a chance to see four shots from the 1 yard line. Here it is again. Pickens looking back for the ball, and Young, a wise veteran, slowing down, and Pickens could not elude the contact.
You saw the way Young started to raise his hands as if he was going for the ball, and Pickens bumped him at that point.
Tim Terrell, touchdown, and the Rams tie it at 20. Terrell from Northern Illinois, free agent pick from the Falcons in 84, and he made the Rams as a special teamer. Good blocker, one of those guys that overachiever that just plays hard for you no matter where you use him.
A little airborne here. Terrell, who does most of his work on special teams, so he knows how to fly.
20-20, Lasher's try for a point is good. Well, I must say, and this isn't just to try to sell this game, but for the first preseason game, this second half, no turnovers, the offensive action has been quite remarkable.
Very few penalties, and we've had an awful lot of substitutions. I think it's the kind of game that both coaches are going to end up being very pleased with.
So in three plays, the Rams go 70 yards with a penalty. It took them only 53 seconds. And they take the lead 21-20 with plenty of time remaining, 6 minutes and 13 seconds. So a quiet first half, 7-6 at the intermission, the Rams leading. And we've had two touchdowns apiece here in the second. High but short to Lang at the 14. And he's out to the 31-yard line. Terrell, who just scored the touchdown, in on that tackle, along with Norwood Van.
I think they may have singled him out and looked for him on this one. They said, hey, that's the guy who scored a touchdown. Let's see if we can put a helmet on him. He's the first one down. Look how he breaks down there.
Ooh. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my.
Are you the guy who scored that touchdown? Wow.
Oh, my. 31-yard line. Kubiak back at quarterback for Denver. Now you have a sense that each coach wants to come away with a win. Orson Mobley in this wide open second half, and the tight end all the way to the 46-yard line. Ed Zeman, a rookie, made the tackle. 22 yards for Mobley.
Zeman, a fun story. Had a tryout last year with Chicago. Played here with the Bears last year. His father, Bob Zeman, coach for the Broncos at one time, for also for the Los Angeles Raiders.
Played for the Chargers, a defensive back. Mobley, who had been nicked earlier in the week, shaken on that last catch.
Well, the one thing you don't want in these early games, and certainly in this one, is injuries, and this game has been relatively injury-free.
Nateel split to the bottom of the screen. Steve Sewell inside the 45, a gain of nearly 5. Donald Evans, the Rams' top pick, in on that stop, number 64. He's from Raleigh, North Carolina. So the Broncos going with basically a unit that looks with a lot of first teamers in there. Gerald Wilhite with Sewell behind Kubiak. Going deep. Nateel. Touchdown. No, stolen away. The Rams have it. Clifford Hicks, 15-20. And he's out to the 21. In a battle of outstanding rookies, Clifford Hicks took it right out of the paws of Nateel. What a play.
Two rookies responding instinctively as they race downfield. Watch this ball drop in over the shoulder of Hicks, and he plays it like a wide receiver. The best defensive backs think they own that football, and Hicks showing a little class there and then getting upfield and doing a good job of running that back for some extra yardage.
From our angle and from that camera angle, it looked as if it was Nateel who had slipped behind to make the catch, but Hicks, and if you're going to give an award, and we are, he has to be in the running for the Budweiser player of this game. He's done everything well, the rookie from Oregon, and that's exactly what a coach wants, a rookie to come forth and show his mettle. So the Rams leading 21-20 with 4.5 minutes left, and Charles White smothered after a 2-3-yard gain.
Well, the Rams were not given high marks by many of the national publications for their draft, but Hicks is one of the bright spots.
Just think, these coaches have to go back after the long ride home, break down the film, study just how well these new faces did perform. Third down and 7 for the Rams. Dills over the middle, incomplete to Chuck Scott, their number 2 pick of 85 from Vanderbilt. And so, with no time consumed, 3:42 left, the Rams have to give it back by way of the punt to Denver.
One of the interesting things about this game is both these teams have to get on the plane and go home. And that's a long flight after this ball game. They'll both fly back home tonight.
Denver, however, doesn't play till next weekend. Game in Arizona. And the Rams have to come back, play at home at Anaheim Stadium on Thursday night. High kick by Bowman. Nateel. The crowd building with anticipation as Nateel, those wheels spinning as he received and returned to the 45, a 5-yard return, 37-yard kick, and Denver good field position at its 45.
One of the things that Broncos are hoping is that the heat wave that had a hold of Colorado when they left is going to be broken when they get back. They'd had the hottest weather in over 100 years, 95 plus, pushing up toward 100 degrees. They were glad to come over here. It's very cool over here.
There's Hicks, who took one away from Nateel. I thought you were going to give Ricky Nateel the nickname Heatwave. That
Heat
wouldn't
wave.
Be too
that
bad.
That wouldn't be bad, no.
Kubiak down the middle, incomplete. Leaping try by Nateel. I talked with him a couple days ago at Crystal Palace, where the two teams were working out, and learned that he had never seen an NFL game in person. He's playing in the first that he's ever seen. And I said, well, what do you like to do? He said, well, I like kids. I have my degree in counseling. He works rehabbing juvenile delinquents and drug problems. And he said, I just love kids. What a great answer. Nateel, number 1 pick of Denver. Time remaining, fourth quarter. Denver down by 1. And they're not that far, a couple of first downs from field goal range. Well, Dan Reeves, of all the people that'll praise Ricky Nateel, he's the one who has most at stake.
Well, Ricky Nateel has been probably the most exciting rookie that we've had in our training camp this year. He's caught a touchdown pass in every scrimmage that we've had. He's been impressive in every drill that we've had. I think he's going to be certainly an impact player, and we're interested also to see what he does on kickoff and punt returns.
Nateel, he's a package of power at 5'9 and 180. 2:45 left in the fourth. Denver trails the Rams by 1. Kubiak, is it good? Yes, complete to Nateel at the 35-yard line. Ed Zeman on the coverage.
Well, I think that's what Dan Reeves was talking about.
He has so much speed deep, you have to respect that, and then he just breaks his pattern underneath and is wide open for Kubiak. And a good job sensing the sidelines.
I think one of the advantages of a player coming out of a program, he came out of Florida, they throw the ball, they run a pro system. He's not an inexperienced receiver. It's as if he had been trained for this kind of setup.
2:38 left in the final period. Gerald Wilhite up the middle. And number 99, Alvin Wright, 265-pounder, makes the tackle after a 3-yard pickup. And that'll probably take us down to the 2-minute warning, and the Broncos already in long field goal range would like to pick up 10-15 yards more, and a field goal could win it for them. . 21-20 the Rams, with Denver with the ball. Kubiak trying to strike down the middle to Nateel. Touchdown! Nateel's fifth catch of the game, a 32-yard touchdown. And Denver is back in front 26-21 with 1:53 left. Did they score too soon?
Dan Reeves said that Nateel had caught a touchdown pass in every scrimmage that they had had. Well, he's added one in his first game as an NFLer, and an impressive one at that.
The regular kicker, Rich Carlos, to try the extra point. It's good. For this crowd of over 80,000 at Wembley Stadium, thoroughly entertained. And the Broncos now on the lead, 27-21. The rookie Nateel's presence felt.
So the Rams 6 points behind and only 1:53 left on the clock.
And the Broncos now to kick to the Rams, and we'll see how John Robinson plays it, how far he goes toward that first team. See if he can rally.
No one's going to sleep yet.
Wagner's kick is short. I believe that was 38 John Embry, a tight end from Colorado, who returned it. Or was it Chris Hardy, 39? Charles White, he has a long way to go to score, and hits it all the way inside the 20-yard line. Beautifully executed screen, and the quality, the high level of play in this second half continues. It has been an offensive show for these fans in England.
Charles White, who ran so effectively at the beginning of this second half, takes this little screen pass to the outside, gets some good blocking. Tom Newberry, 66, one of the blockers, sidesteps, gets away from Braxton, and then steps out of bounds to kill the clock. He's down to the 18-yard line. We've got just a few minutes on the clock. A minute, 36 seconds on the clock.
Kevin House to the 11-yard line. Short yardage. We presume the Rams have at least two of their timeouts remaining. The access to the game statistics is not as readily available as we would have in an NFL stadium, as you might well imagine. The ball just outside the 10. Clock ticking at 110-109. The Rams trailing 27-21. A touchdown and extra point could win it. White, draw play. Nothing there except orange, and they crush White. Steve Wilson, valuable veteran, number 45, last to get up off the pile. Clock stop, timeout Rams with 50 seconds remaining. 27-21, John Robinson, the headmaster of the Rams, with one timeout remaining, 50 seconds showing on the game clock, and his team 7 points from victory, and they are just 8 yards from the end zone. See, Jim Everett is starting quarterback, number 11 behind him. Meanwhile, Coach Collier and the Bronco defense trying to find the right answers on first and goal. White, and wisely, the veteran using the sidelines. No gain. Randy Robbins made the defensive play. It is second and goal with 45 seconds left. Rick Dennison calling the defensive signals from Colorado State.
One of the things you worry about when you bring teams over this early in the year is they're not going to be ready to play, but these teams were certainly ready for this one this evening. More than ready.
Dills over the middle to Terrell. Incomplete. He did not have possession. A scramble on the goal line. Tyrone Braxton saying he has the ball, which he may well have, but was ruled incomplete, and the clock stopped with 40 seconds. For the fans, it's nice to say thank you to these British fans, and they have received that from these two teams. Third and goal, Dills. Incomplete, but a flag is down at the goal line, and we may have had a penalty against the Broncos.
Of course, that penalty would carry
If it's holding, it carries the first down, and nothing could be better for the Rams, because without the penalty, it would have been fourth and goal.
A holding call against the Denver defense. Kevin House, number 83.
Kevin Clark is 27, a rookie from San Jose State.
Realized he was going to get away from him and just put the clamps on him. There you see the flag coming in after the fact, but it's a first down call on the 4-yard line. Play coming in. Zampezi, of course, upstairs in the coach's box, phoning those plays down to the sideline, and they're messengered in.
At the distance of the goal line, a 4-yard penalty, and four downs go with it. 34 seconds remain.
I'm impressed with what both these second-team quarterbacks, Dills and Kubiak, have done in this second half.
Kevin House and Michael Young to the left. They run the other way to Charles White. Touchdown, Los Angeles. You think they'll sell tickets next year for this one?
I think everyone on the Denver side of the line expecting the ball to be in the air, but Ernie Zampezi crossed them up. They handed the ball to Charles White, and Charles, who's had a fantastic second half here, continues to show us what he can do with it.
And now Lansford, the top kicker for the Rams, who has been back and forth across the pond all week, tries to win it for the Rams.
And if he misses, well, let's not think about that. Oh!
Lansford barefoots it through. 28-27 Los Angeles. Denver has 28 seconds to get in field goal range.
But Charles White was confident that 28 seconds wasn't going to be enough. And as the clock ticked down, Gary Kubiak had one last desperate attempt to win it back for the Broncos.
Kubiak.
There it is, hanged up.
Last play of the game, incomplete. And this game is over. American Bowl 87, won by the Rams, 28-27. They loved it in London.
What a great game.
It was, wasn't it? And I think the Rams showed there that they've got the potential to go all the way to the Super Bowl this year.
No, I don't think so. The Rams are in the same division as the 49ers, and the San Francisco 49ers this year will win the Super Bowl.
No, sorry, it's going to be the Jets. That's our...
The Jets? That's a joke,
all right,
yeah?
We'll see. Those are our
predictions. The 49ers, put your money on the 49ers now.
Yeah, we'll see.
There were a couple of things, though, that I didn't actually understand about the game we just seen.
Like what?
Well, what's a lateral pass?
A lateral pass is just one that goes sideways.
All right. I noticed that only the quarterbacks got sacked. Does that mean they lose their jobs?
No. When they get sacked, that means that they get caught in possession with the ball by the defense.
And that's what every defensive team wants to do.
That's right.
One more thing. Hicks and Natiel were the rookies of the game. What's a rookie?
A rookie is a player who's in his first year in pro football.
Oh, like Vince Testaverde and Brian Bosworth. Two names to watch out for this season.
But there's bad news for Bears fans, I'm afraid, because Jim McMahon's on the injured reserve list again. So Thomas Jacques, the third stringer from last year, will be starting at quarterback. But the fridge will be there.
Did you know that William Perry, the fridge, has been told by his coaches that for every pound he's over £312, he gets a fine?
Wait a minute, 312, that's 22 stone.
22 stone, yeah. And for every pound he's over, he has to pay a fine of $5. At the moment, he stands at a big £325. That's not a fridge, but a fridge freezer. And he's $65 down at the moment, and it gets doubled every day.
But on the Giants' side, things haven't been going too well in the pre-season games. And John Smith has tracked down Bill Parcells to ask him his thoughts on the new season and the up-and-coming Bears game.
Welcome back to a new season, and a Super Bowl defense by a new champion, the New York Giants, who begin this year's defense against last year's champions, the Chicago Bears. And with me is the Giants coach, Bill Parcells. Bill, pretty tough one against the Bears this year.
Oh, yeah, obviously. They beat us very soundly in 85 in the playoffs to eliminate us from contention, and we haven't played them since. And I'm certain it's going to be a battle royal. But it is just the opening game of the season. And I kind of regard this season more as a marathon, not a sprint race.
Well, you've seen what's happened to previous Super Bowl champions. Why do you think they've had such a hard time in the last 10 years to repeat since Pittsburgh?
Well, I think every team in the league has a hard time doing anything every year. Things have to go very well. You have to be fortunate enough to be able to maintain consistency on your roster. If there's a tremendous volume of interchanging of players, it's very difficult to keep the continuity. And, of course, the competition is viewing you as something a little special, so they make a more concerted effort to play at their optimum level when they play you. So you combine all of those elements together, and it makes it more difficult for a team to sustain over a long period of time.
Which Chicago Bear on offense provides the most trouble for you?
Well, I hate to single anyone out, but I would probably have to say Willie Gault, their fine split end. He's capable of scoring, you know, very quickly for them. Not to diminish the value of Walter Payton, obviously, may be the greatest, you know, running back to ever play. But I think from an explosive standpoint, Willie Gault would be the guy that concerned me the most.
What about on defense, this famous Chicago defense?
Well, I could enumerate a lot of those guys. They have some great players. Dan Hampton, Richard Dent, Mike Singletary, Otis Wilson, Wilbur Marshall, you know, Duerson and Bell are both fine players. They just have a very, very talented array of individuals on their defense.
What has Lawrence Taylor meant to the Giants?
Well, he's meant a tremendous amount over the period of the 6 years he's played. He's one of the few players in the league that has the capability by his play to inspire others. And he certainly is an integral part of the structure of our defense and has been for a long time.
Parcells there has nothing to worry about. The Giants will walk it on Monday night.
I'm sorry, but the Bears are going to win.
The Bears won't win. McMahon's out, Tom Shack's in. He can't even throw the ball.
Yeah, but they've got Payton.
Don't be stupid. Payton won't even get past Lawrence Taylor. Lawrence Taylor is a killer.
Don't touch me, I'm a real live wire. Psycho killer.